expect all of the people to understand all of the people's problems. But it is my job to try to understand all of the problems. That I must never let the greater interest of all the people down merely because that might be, for the moment, the easiest personal way out.
I think it's really important to understand the historical context of what the freedoms are.
Where they're needed the most and who needs them the most.
My father took me into the voting booth and had me pull down all the levers. He just showed me which ones to pull down. So I voted at 5 for Franklin Roosevelt, and like any young child, became very curious about who this Franklin Roosevelt was.
The first is freedom of speech and expression everywhere in the world. The second is freedom of every person to worship God in his own way, everywhere in the world. The third is freedom from want. The fourth is freedom from fear.
What do you remember about FDR?
His voice.
If I hear his voice, I recognize it. I would recognize it instantly.
My grandmother used to make the whole family listen to FDR's fireside chat.
I think it is right on this Sabbath evening that I should say a word in behalf of women and children and old men who need help, immediate help in their present distress, help from us across the seas, help from us who are still free to give it.
Roosevelt was always seen as part of the war against fascism, part of the fight to bring America out of isolationism.
The way of thinking or the way of feeling about government that goes along with having grown up in that period, that government was a beneficent force.
Some of these work programs and social service programs were really what saved the country.
Those of us who had working papers, if you were 13, 14, 15, or 16, we could get work in the garment district or in the post office because everybody else was at the war. He made us feel like that was our way of supporting the troops who were all fighting the war for us. And, you know, it was important. I used to deliver special delivery to a lady who lived on Washington Square West. You know that street? Yeah. On the other side of the park. And she would get once a week a letter from Eleanor Roosevelt. And I used to tell the guys in the bar, man, I delivered a letter that Eleanor Roosevelt mailed. You know, I thought, so what? They were saying, well, what do you mean, so what? I said, that's the president's wife, man.
Mrs. Roosevelt became a luminous presence in our lives, as in many.
She was a pushy lady, which is the first lady of this country that was a pushy lady, interested in the political life of the country and the social life of the country. We never had a first lady that did that before.
Poor, poor people, out of work. And she never once faked it. She wore the same frocks, as they were called, there that she wore in New York City, and she used the same horses. I mean, and they knew it, that she was real.
I was shopping with my mother. We were out in the street. We heard it. And the sense of shock and loss was not unlike hearing about Kennedy's assassination or Martin Luther.
And I heard about it, and the sun was shining, and I was crying. I remember that very clearly.
I don't think there was another president who sat in it as beautifully as he did.
He was just like a beneficent presence. I mean, he was, you know, you felt safe as long as FDR was in charge.
It was a sense of his hovering. I don't mean he's an angel up there. He was just there all the time.
I sort of want to look up to somebody, you know, like Papa or something. And he was it. He was absolutely wonderful.
I think the Roosevelts were critical in that sense of community. And neither of them faked it. They were both. He was a rich kid from the Hudson Valley who'd been here since 1680. And he talked that way, and he had this affected cigarette. He never faked anything. And so people either hated him wholeheartedly, or they loved him no matter what they were. And the same with Eleanor.
Throughout this entire experience, it's really opened my eyes to want to sit down and talk to people that are older than me and not be scared or feel any type of disconnect.
When I was 18 and went for the draft thing, I was raised to be honest. And I told the psychiatrist there that I had checked the box that said homosexual. The minute I did, I regretted it because I knew it was a great price to pay for this.
Did your parents ever realize that you were gay?
Realize? I told them when I was 19.
And how did they feel about it?
My mother said it was not a subject that would ever be brought up again. And it wasn't. She hated it. But she had to deal with it, you know. Okay, I wouldn't talk about it, but that was it. I also moved out of the house when I was 19 and moved out on my own. I had to take responsibility and the consequences of what I was doing. I don't regret it at all.
The Episcopal Diocese of New York sent out a call for all ordained, as many ordained people as possible, to get to ground zero, because people were in the need of prayer and service. I mean, these big burly guys driving these long, huge trash trucks and the like were just breaking down. They were crying and they were going to pieces. It was a very strange experience. It's the closest thing, in my judgment, in my mind, to Dante's Inferno that I'd ever seen. I did everything down there, from being out on the street to standing on the edge of the pile to working in the morgue blessing remains, you know. I put in almost 400 hours.
A lot of the things that FDR was trying to achieve still relate to us. Social security laws that he was trying to push, that is also a big heavy thing that a lot of people still argue about and debate to this day.
We shouldn't have that sense of being the only one. I think we should all have a sense that we are all equal, but different.
I used to drive a little Volkswagen, and anywhere I went around, if I saw a picket line, I'd stop the car, park it, and get on the line, you know? And I don't know why, but I used to think that was exciting and important.
I'm not a fearful person, ever. I'll jump in wherever I have to jump in.
I learned to stand up for what was right, you know, no matter what.
What more do we have to do to achieve the Four Freedoms?
I think it begins at home. We are products of our families. And if we have parents who are biased in some particular way. We may decide not to be, but we have that influence.
Everything represented by the Four Freedoms needs constant attention and fighting for and protecting.
Speak up when it comes up.
The Four Freedoms, the basis of the United Nations for the rest of the world, so that what happened in 1940 or 1939 actually should never happen again.
Everything. You have to do everything. You have to supply them with the basic needs of life, food, clothing, and shelter. When that can be done on a gracious basis without scrounging, would be a miracle.
It is whispered by some that only by abandoning our freedom, our ideals, our way of life, can we build our defenses adequately, can we match the strength of the aggressors. I did not share those illusions. I do not share these fears.